explodes against the judge who said a drunk can consent to sex. Officials fear a vigilante backlash. WikiLeaks appears to lay bare the shocking cyber reach of the CIA. They could turn your phone into a listening device. Plus, three tax judges under investigation after CBC News raises questions. Anger over an acquittal in a sexual assault case boiled over into the streets of Halifax today. Hundreds gathered to express their contempt for something the judge said in his decision. Quote, clearly a drunk can consent. And that statement has sent a shockwave across the country. Angela McIver has the latest.
If someone is too drunk to say yes, they are too drunk to say no. This is a concept anyone in a courtroom should know.
The crowd was moved when Ashley Avery recounted what many women have faced, the case of taxi driver Bassem Al-Rawi and Judge Gregory Lanahan's decision to acquit him brought about 500 people together in protest.
The victim did everything right. When you get into a cab to get home, you think that's the safest route. And to have something like that happen, to get raped when you think you're getting a safe drive home, and then for the rapist to take it off, it's outrage.
Al-Rawi was accused in May of 2015 of sexually assaulting a 26-year-old passenger. Halifax police had been in the area when they noticed his cab was parked. When officers got closer, they saw the man in the back seat of his cab with panties in his hand. The female passenger was naked from the waist down. She was highly intoxicated. In his decision last week, Judge Gregory Lanahan said the Crown did not prove the case beyond a reasonable doubt. Then he went even further to say clearly a drunk can consent. Those comments continue to hit a nerve with people across the city.
It's very blatant that consent could not have been given. I did a little bit of research, as I'm sure a lot of people here did, to find out what consent, how consent is defined in Canada. And if one is inebriated or incapacitated in any way, consent cannot be given.
No means no!
This outrage has prompted police to express concern about both the judge and Al-Rawi's safety.
We appreciate that folks are upset, they're frustrated. We certainly wouldn't encourage any vigilantism. We don't condone it either. And mostly we wouldn't want people to get sort of themselves in trouble as a result of frustration or anger.
Many people have complained about Lanahan's conduct. At least one has been accepted as an official complaint. But the outcome of that investigation can't reverse his decision in the taxi case.
The Crown also announced today it is appealing the ruling. The prosecution service cites several grounds where it believes Judge Lanahan erred in the law, including what the Crown believes was speculation on the issue of consent. Angela McIver, CBC News, Halifax.
Nova Scotia announced today that it will hire two special prosecutors to handle sexual assault cases. And Halifax is also now looking at better ways to regulate taxi licenses. The city unanimously passed a motion today making safety a priority and ensuring that drivers are more carefully scrutinized. WikiLeaks has revealed how the CIA co-opts personal electronics to listen in on almost anyone, unsuspectingly. That's the bombshell we learned after the group exposed tactics that had, until now, been company secrets. Paul Hunter explains.
Here's a test. See if you can spot the potential CIA secret listening devices somewhere right here, hiding, as they say, in plain sight. Give up? Well, that's one right there, a Samsung Smart TV. Oh, and there's another, a regular old iPhone. That's right. In what's being described as the biggest ever leak of CIA documents published today by WikiLeaks is a treasure trove of high-tech spy secrets, suggesting the CIA can not only turn random privately owned iPhones into live microphones unbeknownst to their users, but it's hacked into people's Androids as well, and laptops and iPads. Think you've got encryption? Think again. It can hack through that as well. As former CIA staffer and leaker Edward Snowden put it today from wherever he is, in hiding in Russia, imagine a world where the actual CIA spends its time figuring out how to spy on you through your TV. That's today. If That is, you're not in the U.S. The CIA is forbidden by law from spying on Americans.
All of the intelligence community's activities are directed at foreign targets, foreign terrorists, and foreign government officials overseas.
Still, the leak's not just another embarrassing security breach for U.S. intelligence. Say many, it's dangerous. While there's no how-to-do-it guide in the leak, all those tricks of the trade are now out there for anyone.
If it is that, it would be very, very damaging.
WikiLeaks! I love WikiLeaks!
Back when he was a candidate, WikiLeaks was applauded by Donald Trump as it published emails damaging to Hillary Clinton. Today, the White House wouldn't wade in on talk of this latest leak.
I'm not going to comment on that. I think, obviously, that's something that has not been fully evaluated.
Worth noting, another aspect of how the CIA does its business, according to WikiLeaks, is that when it hacks into devices or servers or whatever, it can cover its tracks and make it look as if the hack was by someone else. For example, say, Russia. Paul Hunter, CBC News, Washington.
Well, 8,761 documents were released today by WikiLeaks, and in that huge tranche of files, there's just one mention of Canada, but today's leak could put Canadians at risk. Our tech reporter, Matthew Braga, has that part of the story.
Some of its spy software the CIA bought. Some of it was developed in-house, and some of it acquired from partners, such as the NSA. Experts have called the tools impressive.
I would be more concerned now than I was yesterday.
And it's not the CIA security expert Julian Sanchez is afraid of.
So these are, you know, vulnerabilities that affect the security of a huge number of people. And especially if hackers or foreign intelligence agencies are then stealing the weaponized versions of these exploits from the government itself, that's an enormous number of people who are put at unnecessary risk.
The CIA's capabilities are not unique. Rather, they are part of an ever-expanding digital toolbox, touted by law enforcement and intelligence agencies as the future of their trade.
On iPhone?
Officials say that the encryption found in phones and used by apps such as WhatsApp has made it difficult for them to gather evidence. So, instead of breaking the encryption itself, government hackers have turned to other methods. Secretly planting targeted software on wireless routers, smartphones, and even smart TVs. According to documents released by WikiLeaks, CIA hackers hid their spy software inside popular apps such as Skype and Chrome. In smartphones, they took advantage of numerous security holes, some that not even Apple or Google knew about.
One of the documents actually describes a meeting held in Ottawa in the summer of 2015 when unnamed intelligence agencies went hunting for new iPhone bugs. Matthew Braga, CBC News, Toronto.
More concerns at Jewish community centers, the ones in Toronto and London, Ontario, were forced to close this morning because of bomb threats. Buildings were evacuated and authorities investigated for several hours before people were allowed back in. Similar threats were called in or emailed to Jewish community centers and schools across the United States. The Center for Israel and Jewish Affairs says more than 120 bomb threats have been received across North America just since the beginning of this year. Well, a new twist in the brazen public murder of North Korean leader Kim Jong-un's half-brother. A video has emerged on YouTube in which a man claims to be Kim Jong-nam's son.
My name's Kim Han-sol, from North Korea, part of the Kim family. My father has been killed a few days ago. I'm currently with my mother and my sister.
At one point in the video, he shows his passport, but the details are blacked out. So is some of the audio. This popped up on the website of a human rights group, which says it's protecting members of Kim Jong-nam's surviving family. Three Canadian judges are now being investigated for possible misconduct over their relationship with the accounting firm KPMG. Canada's judicial watchdog organization ordered the probes after questions were raised by CBC News and Radio-Canada. And as the Fifth Estate's Gillian Finley tells us, it's all about the line between business and pleasure.
The Fifth Estate's investigation took us to Madrid, site of the International Fiscal Association's annual conference. Accountants, lawyers, regulators, and judges from around the world They come to learn, and they come to party. And it's the parties that seem to have gotten the Canadian judges into trouble. Among the sponsors this year, accounting firm KPMG, the company behind an offshore tax scheme the Canadian Revenue Agency says was intended to deceive. A case is currently before Canada's tax court. And yet our cameras captured two judges attending events linked to KPMG. One was at Madrid's famed Prado Museum. The man with the gift bag is Justice Denis Peltier with the Federal Court of Appeals. At first, his office denied he was there. When we said we had videotape, they conceded he was, the denial a miscommunication, they said. A few nights later, it was a private party sponsored by the international law firm Dentons. It was a Dentons Canada lawyer who assured KPMG its offshore scheme was legal. Among the guests, a judge from the court that will decide if that was true. Justice Randall Bocock is not the trial judge, but he manages the file day to day at the tax court. A conflict of interest? Canada's Judicial Council is now investigating.
I think in the public interest and for the judge's own interest, it's good for the council to shed light on the situation, to review the issue, and to come to a decision as to whether or not there is potentially misconduct there.
When we first questioned Bocock's attendance in Madrid, it was his boss who got back to us. Tax Court Chief Justice Eugene Rossiter was satisfied that Bocock had not placed himself in a conflict. But Rossiter himself is now under scrutiny, too. For comments we recorded at a recent tax conference in Calgary. Nothing wrong with judges socializing with tax industry officials, the Chief Justice said. The more the better.
And we will have pizza. And we will have wine. And lots of
other. Chief Justices, of course, are considered to be role models. Judges, in general, should exercise some restraint.
It is unusual for the Judicial Council to investigate judges. If misconduct is found, the cases will be referred to a panel for further investigation and possible sanctions. In the meantime, the three judges in question remain on the bench. Gillian Finley, CBC News, Toronto.
Coming up.
We will be grateful to working with the Canadians.
Iran is hot to do business with Canadians, and the Liberals promise to re-establish relations. Nahla Ayed looks at the stumbling blocks. Plus, what rights do you really have when crossing the U.S. border? The government will table its second budget 2 weeks from now on Wednesday, March 22nd. The expectation was that the finance minister's plan would focus on innovation and getting Canadians ready for what all that means. But as David Cochrane tells us, Bill Morneau's plan has been scaled back.
Bill Morneau's second budget is coming 1 year to the day after his first.
March 22nd at 4 p.m.
And in addition to the common date, you can expect some common themes.
Our budget will be a continuation of our program to grow our economy, to help middle-class Canadians.
But what won't be there is the long-anticipated innovation agenda, at least not in full. A senior government official tells CBC News this budget will be short on new spending. There will be a down payment on the innovation agenda in the form of skills training to help Canadians adapt to a rapidly changing workplace where they can expect to change jobs multiple times in their career. But it won't deliver a fully formed plan to reshape the Canadian economy.
I'm confident that will help Canadians to get the skills they need in a challenging economic environment.
Morneau is taking this modest approach in part because there isn't a lot of money to spend, not with a sluggish economy and after spending big on child benefits and infrastructure a year ago. But another reason is Donald Trump.
We will provide massive tax relief for the middle class. We must create a level playing field for American companies and our workers.
Trump's promises of massive tax cuts and infrastructure spending is a key factor in Morneau's wait-and-see approach. That same high-level source says the fiscal update set for this fall will take on extra significance, almost like a second budget, to factor in the full implications of the U.S. budget.
This is very serious. If the Trump administration tables some new direction to have less fees and less tax for business, well, we must address it.
Our budget's very much about focusing on how we can help Canadians, how we can help Canadian families.
With no big new spending on the way, government officials tell us the centerpiece of this budget will be more specifics on spending announced last year, greater clarity on things like infrastructure and economic development plans. If last year's budget laid out the bones of the Trudeau government's plan, this year's budget will put some meat on those bones. David Cochran, CBC News, Ottawa.
Manitoba MP Nikki Ashton has joined the race to lead the NDP.
I am here because I believe that movements matter, and so does direct political action.
This is her second bid at the leadership. She ran 5 years ago to replace Jack Layton. Three other MPs are in the race: Peter Julian, Charlie Angus, and Guy Caron. The vote for a new NDP leader begins in October. Well, for weeks, we've been showing you the pictures of asylum seekers making their way through snowy fields in the dark of night just to get into Canada and make a refugee claim. Today, the government invited the heads of RCMP and Canada Border Services to brief ministers about what's going on. And for now, the government says everything is under control. But as Cameron McIntosh tells us, there are concerns that won't last.
In CT Alley's kitchen, the door is open to refugee claimants needing a place to stay.
I've been helped, so why not help people?
In November, she crossed the border herself, here near Emerson, Manitoba, where she filed a refugee claim saying she was in danger at home in Djibouti. She was successful. Now she qualifies for social assistance, has an apartment, and is starting off in Canada, trying to help others get started.
Some people, they think as soon as they get come here, they get help, the government will help them, they will have a house and all of that. It's like a dream.
Today in Ottawa, the heads of the RCMP and Border Services met with the federal cabinet to talk about the border situation, which the immigration minister again insisted is under control.
We'll evaluate that as we get there, but I can assure you that we're closely monitoring the situation.
While international law allows most asylum seekers who cross the border and pass a security check to make a refugee claim, as non-government sponsored claimants, border crossers don't have the same supports as other refugees. That includes short-term housing. In Manitoba, many of those border crossers start out here, the Salvation Army, which is nearing capacity.
Our current resources are quickly filling up. So if people keep coming in large numbers, there's got to be something else that happens.
Manitoba has put some emergency measures in place, short-term funding and housing. And thoughts are turning to the long-term.
I'm from Somalia.
In this class, refugees are learning language skills. By fall, it will likely start accepting border crossers who obtain refugee status.
If these programs get people into the workforce, they develop the skills, they settle here in Manitoba, they're going to be part of our workforce into the future.
As the weather warms, Ali expects others will come.
There is much people coming in, and we need seriously help.
The big question is how many people will end up staying. Ultimately, that's up to the refugee board. Right now, it's not clear how many refugee claimants have been successful, but in 2015, 60% of refugee claims were approved. Cameron McIntosh, CBC News, Winnipeg.
Hawaii will be the first to challenge Donald Trump's newest executive order banning travelers from six Muslim-majority countries. One of Hawaii's lead attorneys says the new ban affects fewer people but still suffers from constitutional defects. With ISIS losing more ground in Iraq, their enemies in Syria made bold moves near Raqqa today. These are newly released images by the Syrian Democratic Forces advancing on Raqqa from the east. The rebel group includes a mix of Arab and Kurdish fighters backed by the U.S. And while they fought, top American, Russian and Turkish military officials met today to plan a final victory over ISIS. But trust between the three allies remains tenuous. And while ISIS hasn't collapsed yet, in Mosul, Iraq's prime minister has a simple offer for those still fighting there. Quit now and get a fair trial or die. He made the pitch while visiting soldiers on the front lines today. Coalition forces also recaptured the main government building in the city. and new warnings about the severe drought in Somalia. The UN says almost half the population needs humanitarian assistance. Today, the country's president called for international aid and spoke out against U.S. President Donald Trump's revised travel ban, which includes Somalia. Officials in BC say a fuel spill off the coast cannot be completely cleaned up, prompting some serious concerns about the impact on the environment. The spill happened Sunday morning at a commercial salmon farm when a diesel fuel nozzle was left unattended. Most of the spill has been contained, but the remaining thin, shiny surface layer of fuel can't be captured by skimmers or by absorbent materials. The leader of a nearby First Nation says that's utterly unacceptable. For many environmentalists, the notion of clean oil is just really a fantasy, especially in Alberta. Oil sands production there accounts for almost 10% of all of Canadian greenhouse gas emissions. But that could change if a pilot project at one Alberta oil company takes off. Rafi Bujikian has the details.
For 3 years now in Fort McMurray's oil sands, Ensolve workers have been extracting oil from deep in the ground, doing it cleaner, the company says, than others in the industry. Usually oil companies use very hot water to soften hardened oil and liquefy it so it can be taken out of the ground. Ensolve uses propane and butane instead, no water at all, creating far less greenhouse gas emissions. The company says it needs public funding to move beyond its pilot project.
Because oil sands are such a capital-intensive development, you're looking at many millions of dollars, hundreds of millions in the case of oil sands development.
For this university researcher, a worthy investment.
I do think there is potential in these processes to certainly reduce CO2 emissions and to more economically recover bitumen. How far we get into realizing that depends partly on companies like Ensolve and other companies trying these processes in the field.
But there are potential pitfalls. This environmental group, which consulted with Ensolve, says the long-term impacts on groundwater and local wildlife are still unknown.
We really need to be extremely careful about the other environmental impact. I'm talking about like land use impact, biodiversity.
The Alberta government says it's monitoring projects like Ensolve's closely.
We've got the right biodiversity frameworks in place, working with First Nations and with communities.
The federal government invested in Ensolve's pilot project, and so did Alberta. Today, the provincial environment minister said she's impressed with the new technology and says Alberta is considering investing even more. Rafi Bujikanyan, CBC News, Calgary.
A small community in Nunavut is struggling after a devastating fire. Last week's fire destroyed the only school in Kugaruk, a town of just 972 people, and a third of them are students.
I missed the school already.
It's going to take time to heal the community.
For sure.
It's a big loss.
The principal says classes could resume in a week or two. They'll be spread among several other buildings in the community until a new school is built. But officials say that that could take 3 years and could cost $30 million. Why? Because the town is remote and the construction season is so short. A 13-year-old has been charged with arson. Straight ahead, there could be lots of money to be made in Iran, but Canadians are at a big disadvantage.
The single biggest tax grab in Canadian history. Finance Minister Michael Wilson's new goods and services tax will bring in $24 billion a year.
People are going to be a little apprehensive about what that change means to them.
Anytime you buy something, you'll be paying the new federal tax.
It's a cruel tax, a brutal tax, a mean tax.
$179.
Business owners say the new tax will mean chaos for them, confusion for their customers.
I don't even want to think about it right now.
In Vancouver, the GST has been dubbed the grief and suffering tax.
I get in the cab and I say, if the cab feels a little sluggish, it's because I've got Mr. Wilson tied up in the trunk. And of course, they know who Mr. Wilson is.
There's a brand new creature coming out of Ottawa. The biggest tax collector that you ever saw. Gonna make you pay your money day and night.
Get more.
So
saloon keeper Von Gromadovich may seem an unlikely leader for a popular tax revolt.
18 months ago, they threatened to tax my haircuts. And that was my, that was it. That was the thing that set me off.
This is what brought the crowd to Parliament Hill, a chance to denounce the government's goods and services tax.
We have to tell Brian Mulroney, take back this tax.
Think of me as a new pet who ain't been spayed. Long as I'm fed, no need to be afraid.
The RCMP refused to allow a group of demonstrators driving Ottawa cabs to circle a hill. The cabbies began pushing to go ahead. A lone tax supporter was turned on.
Before anyone ever pays it, the goods and services tax is coming down. The GST was supposed to be 9%. It's going to be 7%.
Protesters carried placards reminding the government that the most recent public opinion poll puts it at 15%, a new record low in popularity.
If we continue to do the right thing for Canada, not what is popular, but what is right, we will be in first place on election night.
The bill passed this last reading in the Commons to a chorus of boos from hecklers in the gallery.
Unfortunately, Canada, I feel like they've always been a follower to the decisions and the policies of the United States.
Iran is a highly educated country of 80 million people, and more than half of those are under 30. When major economic sanctions were lifted last year, the country's vast business potential seemed clear. Countries like Germany and France dove in fast to sign up deals. But Canada has been a notable laggard, even after the Liberals took power and promised to resume official relations. Nahla Ayad got rare access to Iran's oil fields and spoke to movers and shakers in Tehran who wonder when Canada will get down to business.
Canada's fabled embassy in Tehran first went dark in 1980, post-revolution, after staff spirited six American diplomats out of the country using fake Canadian identities and then followed them out. The second time, in 2012, staff again destroyed sensitive documents, quietly shuttered the same offices, and slipped out in groups to different destinations. This time over security concerns and disapproval of Iran's policies. A vital channel between the West and Tehran was severed, given up along with the keys.
Now fast forward to the 2015 election when the Liberals promised to reopen the embassy in the name of engagement and dialogue. And last year as government, it dropped the warning against all travel here. And Canadians have been coming here. We've met them. But the relationship between the two countries isn't fully mended. And that comes with a price.
Since the Canadians left, Iran has taken a road thick with possibilities. International negotiations leading to rare international agreement to ice Iran's nuclear program in exchange for lifting sanctions on key state-owned sectors like the oil industry. Russia, China, Europe, and the U.S. were on board.
The good news is that there is a solid agreement in place, and according to all the watchdogs, it's working.
As a result, Iran for the West was suddenly open for business. Some are calling it a gold mine. Foreigners rushed in, tens of billions in contracts signed, with the likes of Airbus, even with Boeing in the US, the biggest with a Western company since 1979.
This is a country full of opportunities.
Canadian-Iranian Cyrus Razaghi moved here years ago, hoping to see something just like this.
I think overall the direction is right. An example was Airbus. We took the first aircraft after, you know, almost four decades. That's a good sign.
To truly appreciate Iran's renewed potential, you have to travel southwest, towards the border with Iraq, the front line in their war in the 1980s. This is Iran's oil country, home to its biggest oil field and its grandest sales pitch.
And also, this is the oil processing area.
With escorts from the Ministry of Petroleum, we were invited to visit a processing facility built under sanctions with China's help, a model of cooperation Iran now wants to duplicate with Western companies.
I think about 500 or something like that personnel we have here, but it will be changed.
Reza Golhaki is the health and safety supervisor and our guide for the day.
We will be grateful to working with the Canadians as well.
Unlike Canada's, Iran's oil business is thriving. Here alone, 80,000 barrels per day and rising.
See the oil storage there, which have a 40,000 barrels capacity.
But after years of withering under quarantine, the industry needs foreign investment. It also needs new technology, the kind Canada has in spades. We first met Canadian Ehsan Gayouminia at the airport in Ahvaz, the capital of Iran's oil-rich province. He used to work in Canada's, but when the nuclear deal seemed inevitable, he moved to the country of his birth.
Figured, you know, all these companies in Calgary are suffering and they're having such a difficult time. So I thought it was a good opportunity to help both countries shake hands and bring business, bring Canadian companies to Iran and also bring new technologies to Iran. So that way it would benefit both the countries. It is a gold mine, I'll say it again.
He started talking to Canadian companies even before the sanctions were lifted, and then after, helped them navigate a market poorly understood in the West.
I mean, fortunately or unfortunately, a lot of what I'm doing is what really the Canadian embassy should be doing here in Tehran, which is providing confidence in Canadians to enter the Iranian market, answering their questions, their concerns.
There are also concerns about the sturdiness of the nuclear deal. Hardline elements here and in the U.S. who would rather see that deal die. Donald Trump's tougher line on Iran adds to the uncertainty. For Canadians, this is especially disconcerting. Without an embassy, lives have been complicated. Canadians in trouble, harder to help. Ottawa can't have Iran's ear on human rights or anything else. And yet, beyond a meeting between the foreign ministers last fall, there's been little measurable progress. Not helped by the arrest of Canadian professor Homa Hoodfar or Trump's unexpected win. We put the question to the foreign ministry. Spokesman Bahram Ghassemi said Canada must first remove remaining sanctions.
و امیدوار هستیم که این چند موضوع باقی مانده یا مسئله باقی مانده هر چه زودتر حل و فصل بشه و تفاهم لازم به عمل بیاد و ما بتونیم حداقل در نخستین گام دفاتر حفاظت منافع دو کشور رو افتتاح بکنیم یا باز بکنیم مجدد.
In light of the nuclear deal, Ottawa did lift some sanctions last year to ease business. But Gayouminia says it's not enough.
It's major. I mean, I think the biggest issue is that Canada currently does not have an embassy in Iran.
Ottawa and Tehran still seem far apart. And yet, at a small office behind the Tehran Chamber of Commerce, there's just enough hope. the Iran-Canada Chamber of Commerce is stirring back to life.
Every week, every minute, every month, we expect the relation will be established.
They want to bring back the 2,500 members they once had when Iran was one of Canada's biggest trading partners in the region.
My visa was 3 years, multi, 2 years, multi. It was very easy. It was no problem.
Now?
Now very difficult. I have to go to Ankara, I have to go to Dubai. So that's not good. I'm not going.
Canadians have the problem in the other direction. Yet Gayoumenia's idea seems to be working. He now has several serious Canadian clients, but the challenges have multiplied too.
My number one priority is to dismantle the disastrous deal with Iran.
President Trump is an unforgiving critic of the nuclear deal. He's called it the worst deal ever made, a cash infusion for the terrorist groups Iran finances.
This deal is catastrophic for America, for Israel, and for the whole of the Middle East.
When he was elected, the White House's posture on the deal it helped negotiate changed overnight. Iran points out all the world's major powers signed on, and they did, giving new life to the oil industry and putting aside long-time concerns about who owns what in Iran and whom exactly the lifting of sanctions benefits. Its atomic energy chief and vice president told CBC News if the U.S. violates the deal, then Iran could easily restart its nuclear program.
We will deliver whatever we have been committed to, that for sure. And we expect the same thing from the other side. I think both countries have to take this opportunity seriously to not to destroy the trust which is being built up.
So please come forward. We're going to start in about 10 minutes. Thank you. Take a seat, gentlemen.
The collapse of the deal would be dire and would multiply the region's tensions. But Tehran presses on with its ambitious sales pitch. Razaghi helped put on a well-attended automotive conference. But for foreign investment, the Trump effect has been an unmitigated chill.
For companies who wanted to come to Iran until the presidential elections in the U.S. And then now is the attitude of the foreign companies or and investors is like, wait and see.
Next, Trump included Iranians on a list of banned migrants. Then 9 days into his presidency, Iran tested a new ballistic missile. Trump put Iran on notice. Those with business ties to the U.S. hesitated, and some got cold feet, including two Canadian companies in talks with a private oil firm, one on the very day Trump was elected.
They are afraid of they jeopardize their investment. They deny to continue our relations, so they somehow stop the relation with us, or at least they said for time being we prefer not to continue the situation as it is.
The Trump effect seems to also be influencing Ottawa's decisions on Iran and its advice to Canadians seeking to do business here, according to sources familiar with the conversations. A spokesman for Global Affairs said Ottawa's commitment to re-engage hasn't changed, but that its approach to Iran has always been cautious and incremental. Canadian companies also need to approach the market cautiously with due diligence on ongoing Canadian and UN sanctions. And while Iran remains a country of serious concern, he said, Canada prefers dialogue over withdrawal, so it's willing to have discussions with Iranian officials. No doubt. Canada's decision to reach out to Iran was easier when world powers had a consensus. What to do now when insiders are warning Canada's biggest trading partner could clamp down in a way that might jeopardize the nuclear deal?
Unfortunately, Canada, I feel like they've always been a follower to the decisions and the policies of the United States.
Canada and Iran must still negotiate the terms of restoring ties. Canadians, meanwhile, might miss out politically and economically. One look at the traffic to and in Tehran, and it's clear Europe is well ahead in both.
Canada can be a great partner. It's just some practical issues like not, you know, having high-level diplomatic relations that need to be addressed before, you know, practical business can happen on the ground.
For Canada, regaining some influence here could be the payoff for engaging Iran, but not at any cost. So, promises aside, don't expect it to happen quickly. Nala Ayed, CBC News, Tehran.
Coming up, in recent weeks, some Canadians have had harsh reminders that crossing the U.S. border can pose problems.
The only person that has a right to travel to the U.S. is a U.S. citizen.
Your rights at the customs counter depend on how you're making the trip. Plus, millennials get a bad rap. Well, you'll hear the other side on Viewpoints. Let's check the day's business numbers. The markets were down today. The TSX dropped 20 points. The Canadian dollar closed down slightly. In New York, the Dow lost 29 points, and the price of oil dipped 6 cents a barrel.
It's like you're being treated like a criminal and you're being singled out even though you haven't done anything wrong.
Last night, we told you the story of Manpreet Kaur, a Montreal woman who went to the American embassy looking for answers after being denied entry to the U.S., despite being born in Canada and having a valid passport. Well, with March break coming up and many people heading south, a lot of Canadians have questions about American border officials and their powers. So we asked Ron Charles to find out some answers.
What rights Canadians have when facing a U.S. Customs and Border Patrol agent depend on whether that agent is in a booth at a land crossing or at a desk in the pre-clearance area inside a Canadian airport. Henry Chang is an immigration lawyer specializing in U.S.-Canada border issues.
When you're going to the land border and you're being inspected by a CBP, Customs and Border Protection officer, you're on U.S. soil. You are subject to American laws, which is why when you go, you see they're carrying guns.
He says being on U.S. soil gives the agents the right to detain and interrogate Canadian travelers and search anything they have with them, including electronic devices. But those U.S. Customs and Border Patrol agents working inside the eight Canadian airports that have pre-clearance areas are on Canadian soil.
When you're at the airport, they're not carrying guns because they're guests in our country. So they don't have police powers, they don't have the power to arrest you or detain you. And so if at any point during an inspection at Toronto Airport, for example, you believe that the questioning is unfair, unreasonable, you can say, I've changed my mind, I'm not traveling today, I'd like to leave, and they can't prevent you from leaving.
But Chang says a bill currently before Parliament could change that. Bill C-23 is meant to make it easier for Canadians to cross the border by extending pre-clearance to train stations, marine terminals, and Toronto's Island Airport. Chang says it also gives U.S. Customs and Border Patrol agents at pre-clearance desks more power to compel Canadian travelers to answer their questions.
There is a provision that says that officers will be allowed to use whatever reasonable force is necessary. Does that mean the power to restrain you until you've answered questions? It may very well.
He says that's tantamount to giving agents of a foreign government the right to detain Canadians in their own country.
It was initiated during the Obama administration when people thought everything was going to be fine. In light of the current administration, I won't mention who's in charge of that administration, but we all know. In light of that, I think that perhaps Canadians should rethink the extra power that they're giving to CBP officers.
So far, the answer to that from the Liberal government in Ottawa is that the Charter of Rights and Freedoms will protect Canadians. Ron Charles, CBC News, Toronto.
Coming up, a young man pushes back against the slanders that plague his generation. The cry of the millennials, right after the break.
This is Niagara Falls. And if you've noticed a little more foam at its base lately, perhaps it's mainly because of the beer. Beer that's being dumped by the caseload into the custom shed washroom upriver at Fort Erie.
They are bringing more beer than usual on account of the beer strike in Ontario.
One Hamilton man who shuffled off to Buffalo to pick up a couple of six-packs got his comeuppance. But at least he, unlike many others, was able to kiss his beer goodbye.
A Canadian beer drinking tradition is disappearing fast, and the first place they're feeling it is in the Maritimes. What's vanishing are those squat and stubby dark brown bottles.
The Canadian brewery industry has spent millions of dollars to make the change to long neck bottles, and part of that cost is a result of scenes like this. There's no doubt that Cape Bretoners have done their part to support the brewery industry, and some wonder why the beer couldn't have found its way to a charitable cause. It's a beer drinker's lament. 700 cases of supposedly good brew down the drain, so to speak.
Brewers say the change was inevitable. Light beer has become popular, and American beer and twist-off caps.
I find when you're drinking out of it that it foams up more.
But most beer drinkers have adjusted.
Oh, as long as the beer is still there.
Specialty brewers are on the hop these days, rushing to cash in on more relaxed liquor laws.
Now that Canadian liquor laws are changing, new breweries are springing up all over. There's one in the back of this pub in Kingston, Ontario. But the idea of drinking the stuff that's made in the back room is catching on.
It's got a hell of a lot more body than Canadian beer, I'll tell you that.
It's very smooth, it's very easy to drink.
Hey, Ernie, if you could pitch your Easter.
Yeah. Ernie Knudsen has been coming to this so-called U-Brew store for about 3 years. It's easy and it's cheap. Making your own beer and wine in British Columbia is virtually tax-free. You can brew a dozen bottles here for about $10. Buying it at the liquor store would cost $15.
For the working men, yes, it's the working people, the working class people, it's a way better deal.
Most hours have 60 minutes. This hour has 7 days. Tonight, Ralph Nader charges the Detroit car companies with running risks that can't hurt them, but do hurt us.
I could give an example of the Buick Roadmaster in 1953. The one with power brakes came onto the market, many thousands of them, with a defective braking system. Now,
you mean in the 53 Buick Roadmaster,
with power
a driver
brakes.
Would literally go from normal brakes to no brakes, like
that's
that?
Right, that's right. This is documented in court records, which is very interesting. It shows you that the only way we find out about these things is through the cumbrous process of the judicial system. So what you want to do is make an overwhelming, systematic case to overcome the resistance of industry. The stronger a case you make, the more scientists you have working on the project on an independent, objective basis, the more overpowering the forces of humane automotive technology will be.
My name is Lincoln Anthony Blades. I write about politics and culture. And I'm also a millennial. I want to talk to you about millennial entitlement. Millennials, in case you were wondering, are those of us born between the early 80s and 90s. We're frequently the subjects of studies and think pieces trying to figure out what we want and why we're struggling in today's economy. The usual conclusions are we're lazy, coddled, unfocused, and fragile. Terms which fall under one singular label. Millennial entitlement. It's a term used to degrade our competency and work ethic, but that term is nonsense. Allow me to explain. Growing up, we were taught that if we went to school, worked hard, and got good grades, we'd get good, well-paying jobs. So we took that advice, and we went on to become the most educated generation this nation has ever seen. A recent survey revealed that 36% of employers had begun hiring university graduates for jobs that once only required a high school degree. And we're not talking about high-level jobs, we're talking about mailroom attendants and telemarketers. The choice faced by many of my peers is this: hunt for a dead-end, low-paying job you're overqualified for, or accept an unpaid internship along with thousands of other young Canadians and pray you get a job in your chosen field. Despite having the world's third highest level of educational achievement amongst OECD countries, we lead those countries in having the largest share of graduates earning less than the national median income. But these facts don't paint the full picture. We're regularly labeled as entitled narcissists who demand work-life balance because we're too soft to deal with hard work. But maybe those who have this view don't realize that a decade ago, my generation was forever changed by the global economic crisis. Older millennials, like me, found ourselves facing our first mass layoffs at jobs we'd only been at for a few years. People 28 and younger accounted for almost 70% of the job losses during the 2008 recession. Millennials graduating from university at the time faced a job market so grim, they just went back to school. And if you were in high school or college back then, you saw your parents unceremoniously lose the jobs they devoted so much of their entire lives to. We saw and experienced what blind corporate devotion gets you, and we want no part of it. And now, here we stand, 10 years later, thrust into a new economy and facing a new reality we were never prepared for, and we're making the best of it. Many of us have side hustles that we use to supplement our income in order to survive and get ahead. That isn't the mark of a lazy and entitled generation. That's the work of a group determined to create their own chances and their own luck. For The National, I'm Lincoln Anthony Blades.
The
computer is not an evil genius. It has, so far, neither character nor sex, but it is our indispensable tool for collecting, sorting, and disseminating information.
You feel premarital sex is all right under certain circumstances.
This young lady is seeking a husband the scientific way. The process begins with a psychological examination. By personality test and depth interview, he reduces her to a punch card. Then he runs her through an electronic sorting machine. It matches her personality to suitable men.
Well, right now we're lobbying in various countries around the world to get laws passed which will control the use of computers, especially where large dossiers of information on people exist without any safeguards for the people. It's anonymous information. You never know who's asking for such information. I think we need a kind of licensing structure for computer use, just as we have licensing structure for doctors, we have licensing for dentists, we have other professions which deal with man very basically, and the computers do.
The electronic web, privacy in the computer age.
We are living in a new world of electronic processing of information and simply information gathering on a scale that we've never seen before.
You don't know what happens to personal information once you give it to someone. It can be stored, transferred, linked, matched, all kinds of things can happen.
Updating the messages people have left, clearing out the old ones, and writing new ones takes the guys about 9 hours each day. But by doing it, they've found fun, friendship, and girls.
I have a girlfriend from the modem. Yes, I do.
Information sharing is so phenomenal, so widespread, that it would be impossible to control. It really is impossible to control.
Is there such a thing as privacy then?
No, there hasn't been privacy since, probably about the mid-80s. We've built a beast that we can't cage.
So envision now a way society can be moving in which we don't spend the time to get to know each other. We now do searches. We now do private investigations before we commit ourselves to the traditional ways of creating friendships and acquaintances.
I don't know, usually I would say probably an hour a day, if not sometimes more.
That's how much time Grody usually spends on this website. Facebook is the latest craze when it comes to online friend network.
You just want to know what everybody's doing and check the pictures they put up and whether you're invited to any events. And for most of the reason, I don't know why I check so much.
Privacy was once a sacred value in our society. Now we are bearing our psyches to strangers. The National.
A rare treat for these school children touring the White House today. The Commander-in-Chief surprised the bunch, welcoming the first tour group in the building since he took office. President Trump tried to call the kids over for a photo op, but only one brave little guy took him up on the offer. And in case you missed it, looming over it all, there's Trump's election rival and former First Lady, Hillary Clinton. The Canadian Screen Awards for television were handed out tonight, and this program and some of my most talented colleagues took home lots of hardware. Wendy Mesley won for Best Host or Interviewer. Reporters Adrian Arsenault and Nala Ayed were honored along with their producers, Carmen Merrifield and Tracy Seeley. Those awards were for Best Reportage and Best News or Information segment. And one of our exceptional cameramen, Richard Deavy, was singled out for Best Photography. And The National, there he is, won Best National Newscast. Peter was right there to accept, which is why he's not here tonight. And I'm here with you.
Awarding a lot of great journalists.
That is The National for this Tuesday night. For news anytime, go to our website, cbcnews.ca. I'm Susan Ormiston. Thanks for watching.